it's really kind of a miracle that the Universal Declaration was drafted and adopted by a group of 18 people whose countries were in serious conflict with one another. I think it's important to realize that when the whole enterprise started, nobody in the United Nations or anywhere else was confident that there was going to be a group of principles that people could agree on. And they started in a way, imagine this happening in the United Nations today. They started by convoking a group of philosophers from all over the world to have a discussion on theoretical foundations. And out of that, that was, I think, in 1946, out of that philosophers' roundtable came the sense from many different religions and cultures and parts of the world that there are some things that are so good that no one would dissent from them in principle, and there are some things that are so atrocious that everybody would condemn them. The way I like to characterize the nature of the document is that it is impressively multicultural, but imperfectly multicultural. And I have to say imperfectly, because even though there was a lot of input from a lot of different sources, at the time the declaration was first adopted in 1948, the UN membership did not include sub-Saharan Africa and many other parts of the world. I think we have to be clear that the idea of universality seems to be an idea that does come out of Western traditions. But even though that idea and the form and style of the Universal Declaration could be said to be Western, it is impressive that in 1947 and 1948, representatives of Asian cultures, cultures, nine countries with predominantly Muslim populations, along with Latin America, Europe, and the United States, all those representatives were able to sign on to those principles as universals. And then afterward, practically every constitution in the world that has a Bill of Rights is modeled or influenced in some way by that core of principles that were deemed to be fundamental. I think it's important to distinguish between the goal of a document like the Universal Declaration and the goal of other activities in the human rights area that were going on at the time and that have been carried on since. The Universal Declaration was really not about enforcement. It was about enculturation. It was about setting conditions so that horrible things wouldn't happen, or so that the probabilities of atrocities would be reduced. But education in particular is what the Universal Declaration is all about. That was the idea. That, in fact, there's something in the preamble about the Declaration standing as a sign to all peoples, to all nations. And the idea was that through education, they would somehow find a way to, with different emphases according to the culture, to make these rights a reality. You could almost think of it as a dream about a competition in excellence. There might be different paths toward the goal of protecting the dignity of every man, woman, and child in the world. But nobody could leave any of the rights out. The message for those of us who are facing atrocities either in the past or in the present is that there was a time when men and women, under the most unpromising circumstances, at a time when much of the world was in ruins, when the Palestine crisis was at the very boil, when the Soviet Union and the United States were teetering on the edge of mutual destruction. There was a time when people of different faiths and cultures were able to come together to articulate a path forward toward peace and justice, and that over the 60 years, enormous progress has been made on those fronts. The Cold War is over. Negotiation, faltering, nevertheless, has so far kept people talking about Palestine and Israel, and it's a great affirmation of the possibility of overcoming conflict through reason and goodwill. It's what we've got.